players, right? Any other parties, and then it comes into your hand, and then people ask you to review and revise it. So what should we do? Now, yourself needs to review the documents. You need to review it several times. And when you review it, you should review from different perspectives, right? So I remember that last time one of your friends told me that, oh, this session, teacher, you have already reviewed. So now I just copy the same as what you reviewed for the class. No, never, right? I myself, I need to review my contract many times. But even when I review yours, and then next time I may revise it. But nothing is perfect. And if we can make it more perfect or more uploaded, why not, right? We need to continue reviewing and revising the contract. It's just like when you do your homework, or when you do the tests, just some people like, oh, after doing the test, and then they feel very happy, and then they submit the test immediately. So without proofread it, or without reviewing it very carefully several times, and then you submit it. I don't think you will get the high score for that. Because the contract or any other kind of document, we need to proofread it, we need to review it, right? So that's why after tracking the contract, you yourself need to review your document several times. And what do we mean by different perspectives? Because in the agreement, there may be the legal perspectives. So we review it and revise it just based on the law, right? And also we need to base on the commercial perspective. It's like if we enter into this contract and then with that price, should we do so, or should we negotiate to change it? Like, is this our, the lawyers, it's not the lawyer's duty, but if the lawyer is responsible and then they need to concern the finance team, the accounting team, the technical team, just to make sure that the contract is protected, it's fully protected from different perspective, right? Now, when you review it, so what are the questions that you need to ask yourself about the essential questions from the substantively perspective to the procedural or the format, right? Substantively, does it cover everything that it needs to cover? Yeah, so when you travel the country, will based on the instructions of your clients, or if your client doesn't have any clear instruction, but as a lawyer, you need to envisage and you need to know that, well, with this kind of country, we need to include this information. And with that country, we need to include that information. So it is your job to advise your clients. If your client doesn't have any instruction, any specific or special instructions. However, in some cases, the clients give you instructions. They're very carefully about this one. And some of the lawyers misuse those requirements of the clients. The more serious the client is, the more responsible that lawyer should be. Some clients, they list out everything they need. And even before that, they have the meeting with the other party and agree on some terms, and they give you the term sheets. The term sheet means the document which lists out the main content of the agreement. Just like in our exercise about the lease agreement, so the author lists out important or basic information of the agreement. So it's just somehow the same as a term sheet where the parties agree on some terms. And as lawyer, you just put those terms into the contract where appropriate. But the most dangerous experience is that sometimes lawyers forget or lawyer misses some or one important or one point presented in the term sheet. It is a very big mistake. And the client, of course, is not happy anything about the contract, and they feel that that law firm is not considerate. So people usually do not blame a lawyer himself or herself, but they will blame the whole law firm. It's because in the law firm, they need to delegate the job to one or two lawyers, but then they have the QC procedures, I mean quality control procedure, that should be reviewed by the senior lawyer, and it should be reviewed by a partner, or sometimes a managing partner. So there are lots of things we need to think about, not just like putting into the agreement what you think fits, right? We need to meet the needs of your clients. And the next question is, does it satisfy all the legal requirements? Of course, right? From the legal perspective, we need to check the legal regulations relevant to the law or to the agreement. The party can agree everything, but not those prohibited by the law. So if you want to know which is prohibited by the law, you need to read the law, right? There are some requirements. What if the requirements are beyond the law? I mean, they may be illegal. And we need to tell your clients that they should not put that in the contract, right? In most of the cases, they have a very clear instruction, and we just based on that interrupt the contract. Okay. Does it contain fatal ambiguity? You know, fatal, this kind of ambiguity can lead to the end of the contract, or it can make the business of the parties become worse. So that's why really carefully to avoid any ambiguity. So we have already studied the chapter about how to avoid ambiguity. Does it contain potential loopholes that a hostile reader could explore? Yeah, so if you draft the contract which is too short, and with the law on responsibilities, on responsibilities are very simple, and it's very easy for us to miss this point, to miss the answer of this point. Like, is there any potential loopholes? And that is an internally consistent, right? So in the contract, we'll have different section, and we use the same term, or even different term, like the one that I just reviewed. We use the term payment instead of like a rental fee. Then remember, if we have a definition for that, and you must use that in the form paragraph. Or when you define that, it's just the lessor, which means that you include the article the, and you capitalize it. And then you need to do that the same in the whole document. Right, next. Are the rights, duties, and other legal consequences clearly and equivocally stated, right? So when you define a right or a duty, and you need to think of the legal consequences. So in some cases, you don't need to put the legal consequences into the agreement. In that case, it is implied by the law. Or the objective of the document properly conceptualized. So you need to know the objective of the parties, not just your client, but also other parties, and just make sure the document capture the objective. Any questions? Yeah. So after like asking and answering a very general question on the contract, we need to go into detail, right? If you review the content, and this is a 10-point checklist, and I think I have already presented to you guys, like the parties, the date, the amount, and the interest. Those are the important, it's subject to what kind of agreement it is. So we just give here the example. So in the loan agreement, they have the amount, the interest rate. But for some others, no. In your lease agreement, is there any section that we should include the interest rates? Who knows? Hello, any idea? In our agreement, should we include a clause on interest and payments? Interest rate. Is it all in the lease agreement? Now my answer to you is yes. So can you think of the situation under which you need to use the interest rates? Any opinion? Hello? Yeah. Do you have any idea?
I think that we can have a term in the contract to indicate that the cost or the price would be specified in the attached document.
In what case we refer to the interest rate?
It could be the contract or the agreement of borrowing money or from the bank, the loan.
I mean in our lease agreement.
So what you're saying that should there be an article or a provision related to interest rate in a lease agreement?
Yes.
I think it's no.
In that situation, you have it.
Sorry, miss, I right now cannot think of a situation when we need the interest rate provision.
Okay, who knows? Thank you, Nga. Who knows? Mỹ Long. Hello, Long. He's not on the list. Okay. Wang Min.
Yes, miss. I think the interest rate for a breach of contract, the interest rate for the late payment.
Excellent. This is what I mean, right? In case of the late payment, right? The lessee fails to pay the lessor. The agreement interest rate should not exceed the one regulated by the law, right? And how can we calculate it, right? Based on the date, the numbers of the date of late payment. Yeah, and sometimes people refer to the interest rate announced by a bank, right? So that's good answer, Min. Thanks a lot. Now, appropriate structure. So we have already studied how to organize a contract, right? Clear expressions of duties, rights, and privileges. So if you provide, of course, in the agreement, and most of you are traffic agreements, the structure of a Vietnamese one. So it's kind of mixture, right, in our drafting of the lease agreement. So, you have a section about the rights and obligations. Please make it clear and think about the legal consequences and give them some time to cure if there is any violation. Representations and guarantees, yes, put it there. Internal and external consistency. For internal consistency, would you explain? But for external consistency, it's like in a transaction, we have a set of documents, not just one. So just make sure that those agreements are in line with each other. Substantive understanding, when you travel it, and make sure that you understand it, the other parties understand it. And the most important thing is that it needs to include all the instructions of your clients. Hypothesize performance. I don't think we do something like we act, but we just imagine that in this case, if there's a violation, what should be the solution? For this case, if you want to prepare the agreement, but the lessor does not allow you to do so, and what should we do? And we think about how to perform that. And if you're in breach of the contract, so what could be the legal consequences? Yeah. And I hypothesize that non-performance and default, like I just said, and address bankruptcy risk in case of the one of the party is bankrupt or goes bankrupt and the country is automatically terminated. So we should put that in the section of the termination and consider the worst case scenario. So when the people agree on negotiating, they say, oh, there's no problem, we can pass it. I can sympathize with that. There's no problem. For me, there's no problem. So please delete that. So even you don't put that clause into the contract, we will perform. So in the negotiation, the party usually say like that, but do not believe. You need to put everything in writing. And you said that you will perform this in practice. Yes. So please put it in the contract, right? Some people just say, I will do that, but my boss doesn't want to put that into the contract. So if you don't want to put that into the contract, which means that we have the reason to believe that you may not be perform that in the future, right? So put in the contract everything to avoid any worst case scenario. So where people are already under contract, so they're very, very happy. So there could be no problem at that time, but after that, who knows? Yeah, and then after reviewing the content, then you review the style and the usage. And if the contract is very long, then you should prepare a summary so that it's very easy for you to follow, right? So after you review the contract, send it to other people for their review. Maybe your colleagues, your supervisor. Then it could be fast to review by your clients, then by the opposing counsel, by the lawyer of the other party. You can see that many people will read your contract, not just one. So be very careful. Please keep that in mind when you prep the contract for the class. So you're trying to release a agreement now. Just keep it in mind. Who can read it? Not a teacher, you yourself, your supervisor, your manager, the other party, your clients, right? Any questions? So after this class, I'll send you an exercise for you to review. That is, review a lease agreement. While review that lease agreement, and you can learn something to revise your lease agreement. Any questions?
Dạ cô ơi, là bữa vừa rồi mới có thông báo về lịch thi á cô, thì không biết là hai môn học kỳ vừa rồi của mình thì sẽ thi trong nội dung như thế nào ạ?
Mình có môn dịch với lại môn, mình ba môn chứ hả? Môn dịch, môn môn
social
với lại môn terms terminology phải không? Cái môn thuật ngữ á thì mình sẽ thi trắc nghiệm. Còn hai môn còn lại mình sẽ làm tiểu luận.
Dạ.
Mày có thấy nhà trường tạm ngưng rồi đó. Chắc để dịch ổn định chứ là cho thi trực tiếp luôn á. Giáo viên vừa hả?
Tụi em vừa nhận được lịch thi, cái thời gian thi và cái hình thức thi luôn ạ.
Vừa nhận là khi nào?
Dạ ngày hôm qua cô, tụi em nhận được cái lịch thi rồi ạ. Thi online ạ.
Rồi khi nào thi? Khi nào?
Dạ bắt đầu từ ngày 26 tháng 10 đến ngày 8 tháng 11 ạ.
À. Cô cũng nhận được cái thông báo là gia hạn thời gian nộp đề. Hôm qua, tức là chỉ là thay đổi về thời gian thôi chứ không có thay đổi về cái thức thi.
Okay. Em thấy môn dịch thuật ở trong cái bảng đó ghi là làm tiểu luận đó cô.
Đúng rồi, dịch thuật làm tiểu luận. Dịch thuật làm tiểu luận. Rồi chỉ có môn terminology là làm trắc nghiệm thôi. Phải không?
Dạ đúng rồi cô. Vậy thì cái nội dung mà tụi em cần chú ý để ôn tập là nó như thế nào vậy cô?
Chưa ạ. Cô làm đến thời hạn mới gửi cho trường trưởng. À, nội ý em nói nội dung ôn tập đó hả?
Dạ.
Cái nội dung thi thì cái nội dung mà ra đề tiểu luận á thì lúc đó là sẽ ra thì các em làm theo cái đề đó, và chủ yếu là cái môn môn thuật ngữ thôi. Thuật ngữ thì học sao thi vậy mà nó có mấy cái chủ đề đó không?
Dạ bao nhiêu câu trong vòng bao nhiêu phút vậy cô?
Thì là 40 câu á. Cô không nhớ nữa, 40 câu trong vòng 30 phút hay 25 phút vậy đó. Trộn lẫn tùm lum hết á, nói chung là giáo viên phải ra rất là nhiều câu để nhà trường trộn á.
Vậy còn hình thức thi tiểu luận của mình là tụi em nhận định và tụi em
đưa
là
đề tài thôi, đưa đề tài để các em làm thôi.
Làm trong ngày rồi đọc hả cô?
Nếu phải trong ngày đâu, tiểu luận chứ trong ngày được. Cô chưa thấy cái gọi là quy định cụ thể về cái tiểu luận, cô không nghĩ là trong ngày đâu.
Em có đọc được cái thông tin là về hình thức thi tự luận thì sinh viên chọn đề tài chậm nhất là 2 ngày trước ngày bắt đầu tính thời gian làm tự luận.
Nhưng mà không biết là làm tiểu luận trong vòng cái thời gian nó bao lâu á để nộp bài á, tính bắt đầu tính thôi, nhận được đề tài xong mình làm như thế nào.
Dạ là 7 ngày cô.
Họ gửi cái đó cho cô đi. Cô sợ cô miss cái mail nào của trường. Để qua Zalo cho cô nha.
Qua email á cô.
Để qua Zalo á nha.
Dạ Zalo, dạ.
Em cho Nhàn hết giờ rồi, Nhàn xin vào. Rồi, các bạn về nhà tiếp tục hoàn thiện cái bài của mình ha. Như vậy mình hôm nay là mình đã xong hết cái phần lý thuyết rồi đó.